good and a loving and an awesome God, Lord. Father, we just thank you for this privilege of gathering together in your house and being able to lift our voices up to you and then to open our Bibles and to listen to your voice. So I would pray, Holy Spirit, that now, Lord, you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to receive what you have for us, your people. Lord, we give you glory in all things, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Praise the Lord. We're going to continue our study through the book of Exodus. We made our way up to chapter 8, but while you're opening your Bibles to chapter 8, if you don't have a Bible, we have some at the front and the back of the churches. You're welcome to one of those. But I want to read you a scripture that every time we get rain like this, I just always go back to this because it's so awesome. It's found in Isaiah 55, verse 10 and 11 says, "For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and they do not return there." Have you ever noticed that rain falls this way and not this way? "But it waters the earth to make the earth bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater." Now check this out. God says, "So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it will accomplish what it pleases." Just as the rain causes the flowers to bloom and the plants to grow, God's word causes faith to grow, right? It causes strength and gives us encouragement. And he goes on to say, "And it will prosper in the things which I have sent it." We send the word of God out this morning to bless, to encourage, and to uplift. Amen? Praise the Lord. You guys got your Bibles open to Exodus 8? Y'all seen that great movie, The Princess and the Frog? Yeah, have you? Seen that? Some of you ladies feel like the princess that married the frog? Yeah. Getting a couple elbows here. Yeah. Well, today we're going to look at the Pharaoh and the frog. Or my title is The King Who Almost Croaked. I like that one, but we'll see how it plays out here. We see that God and Egypt are in this massive battle. And we know that Moses has been given the commission to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And as we all kind of seen the movies and know the story, we know what actually happens at the end, but we're studying our way through it. Where we are is God has started the battle of the gods. Egypt worshipped all these different gods. In fact, Pharaoh himself was considered a god. And we saw that in this battle of the gods, we saw last week, plague one was where Moses with the staff of God struck the Nile River and everything turned to blood, remember, and it killed all the fish, and even the water that they had saved in their water pots and stuff in the houses and stuff became blood, and it was just caused a disaster. And in fact, let's start reading at chapter 7, verse 25, because the second plague, the plague of the frogs, begins 7 days after the Nile River thing. So begin reading with me, 7, verse 25. "And 7 days passed after the Lord had struck the river, and the Lord spoke to Moses and said, 'Go to Pharaoh and say to him, Thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me.'" Now it's interesting. Up until this point, right, he says, "Let them go and worship me." Here God says, "Let them go and serve me." Friends, how many of you know that serving God is part of worshiping God? I mean, good commercial for the nursery needs, right? But serving God is part of worshiping God. And worshiping God is part of serving God, right? And so he says, "Let my people come out of there so that they can serve me, so they can worship me." Verse 2, "But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all your territory with frogs. So the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly." This river that has just killed everything. Remember, it killed all the fish. It caused great hurt and harm and hardship to the people. They had to dig their own wells and do all this stuff, right? Now this Nile River that they believe produced life is now producing death. And God says, "I'm going to bring life, frogs, out of this river. And not just a few frogs. They're going to be abundant. Which shall go up and they'll come into your house, into your bedrooms, onto your bed, into the houses of your servants, on the people, in the ovens, and in your kneading bowls. The frogs shall come up on you and on your people and on all your servants." Now we need to remember that all of these plagues went after a god of Egypt. And doesn't the world worship crazy things? I mean, crazy things. Well, they had a god named, I'm not sure if I say it right, but it's spelled in English H-E-Q-T. They forgot the U, but it's H-E-Q-T, and it was a frog, and she was a goddess of fertility and resurrection. Fertility and resurrection, right? And they were considered very sacred in Egypt. You didn't mess with the frogs there. You were nice to the frogs. And he says, you want frogs? You're going to get frogs. Look at verse 5. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand with the rod over the streams, over the rivers, over the ponds, and cause the frogs to come up out of the land. So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. That's just gross, right? I mean, frogs aren't as bad as snakes, but a billion of them? Man. But you know what? If we're not careful, the things that we worship and hold sacred other than the Lord can end up like the frogs. And what I mean by that is instead of being a blessing, they can become a curse. Right? Things that we hold sacred and that we worship other than the Lord can end up being a curse and not a blessing. And that's what's happening with these frogs. Can you imagine the constant croaking and the sounds that all these frogs made? Horrible. Well, look at verse 8. It got to him a little bit, verse 8. And verse 7. And the magicians, Janus and Jambres, all the satanically empowered priests of Egypt, they did so with their enchantments, and they brought up frogs onto the land. Oh, great, more frogs, right? You know, but isn't that what the world does? The world doesn't help. It just adds to the problem, right? Just multiplies the frogs. It makes it worse. And so Pharaoh here in verse 8, I love this, the roles are reversed. Pharaoh now calls for Moses and Aaron. Okay, up until this point, Moses and Aaron have been approaching Pharaoh. Now Pharaoh says, get them brothers in here. And he says to Moses, I love this, entreat. He's saying, pray for me. Intercede for me. Talk to God for me. Entreat the Lord that he may take away the frogs from me and from my people. And I will let the people go that they may sacrifice to the Lord. Now, what we're going to find out here is, like most people, Pharaoh only wanted to be relieved of the pain and the burden of the frogs. His heart really wasn't changed. But now he's calling out and saying, please talk to your God to get rid of these frogs. And I don't know how your guys' mind work, but I'll give you a little insight into how my mind works. If you haven't figured it out already, it's sometimes a little different. But visualize Pharaoh and his crew hanging out. And all the kings of the world are talking, and one of them says to Pharaoh, so how did you lose Egypt? And Pharaoh goes, frogs. You mean it wasn't lions and bears? Frogs. And then in my mind I'm thinking, you know, David, as a little boy, with trust and faith in God, he killed lions and bears. And then giants, right? And then he became the king, right? A little boy trusting God could take on those big beasts. But a person who is stubborn and coming against God, God can destroy with something simple like a frog. Isn't that amazing? It just, the satanic world has got the world fooled into believing that it's got the power and it's got the answer. God can take a frog and destroy your world, right? So he says, please get rid of the frogs for me. We also see in the Bible, who was it talking about me going on rabbit trails today? Gilbert, was that you? Here's trail one. God used hornets, locusts, hailstones. He's used all other kind of simple things to bring victory, we find in the Bible. Isn't that cool? He's going to keep using them too. I've read the book of Revelation. He's got some great ideas in store for this world. I'm going to miss it. I'm going to be eating sheep at the Last Supper. Marriage Supper. Different supper. So he calls for Moses and Aaron. Let's go back to our story because I could ramble. So he says, look what Moses does. I love this. Do you ever just have one of those in-your-face moments with an atheist? No? It's awesome. So Moses says to Pharaoh, all right, I'll pray for you. And you accept the honor of saying when I shall intercede for you and for your servants and for your people to destroy the frogs that you and your house that they may remain in the river only. Here he says to Pharaoh, he says, you want me to pray to get rid of the frogs? I'll pray to get rid of the frogs. But just to prove to you that my God's the real God and your God is about to croak, you decide when you want to get rid of the frogs. And to my utter amazement, look what Pharaoh says in verse 10. Tomorrow. What? Why not right now? He's brushing frogs off of him. Why not right now? But instead he says, no, let me have one more night with the frogs. I'm not sure what he was thinking, but I mean, this would be torturous to people, right? But how many times do people know and are being tortured, and they know that God is the answer, but they want one more night with the frogs? They know the help is there, but we want one more night. Friends, one of my biggest challenges in my personal life is procrastination. And I'm going to work on that next week. But there's a great saying that says this. I found this. Vice has slain its thousands. Pride has slain its 10,000s. But procrastination has destroyed hundreds of thousands. Procrastination. Give me just one more night with the frogs. Got a couple scriptures. First one for the overhead. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 2. Says, for he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. Check this out. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Friends, you can be freed from the frogs of the world. And you can be freed today. You don't have to spend one more night with the chirping and burping of the frogs, right? I mean, how irritating would that be? But how often do we foolishly put up with that in our life, knowing that the answer is the Lord Jesus Christ? You don't have to spend one more day dealing with those situations. Today, God wants to set you free from that. Isn't that awesome? Well, Moses says to him in verse 10, he says, let it be according to your word, that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God. Okay? You want the frogs to leave tomorrow? We'll wait till tomorrow. Verse 11, and the frogs shall depart from you, from your houses, from your servants, and from your people, and they shall remain in the river only. And Moses and Aaron went out from Pharaoh, and Moses cried out to the Lord concerning the frogs which he had brought against Pharaoh. Now, I really like this part. So the Lord did according to the word of Moses, and the frogs died out of the houses, out of the courtyards, out of the fields. Now check out verse 14. Pharaoh was thinking they'd hop away. God just killed them. And look at verse 14. And they gathered them together in heaps, and the land stank. Now remember, frogs multiply fast, right? And they get into everything and everywhere. And friends, we need to be careful that we don't let sin become like a frog, because it will leave a stink if it's not properly dealt with, right? And if you're not careful, that innocent little flirtatious thing you got going on at work can develop into a toad, right? We easily say, well, you know, I only drink at holidays and at the Super Bowl. You be careful, because that toast can become a toad. Well, it's on the internet. Anyone can have access to it. Don't even have to pay for it anymore. Don't feed the frogs, right? Because they multiply fast. They get into everything, and they will make your life stink. This frog goddess was the goddess of resurrection, and now they have to deal with their dead gods. And they stunk. Sin and rebellion will leave a residue, will leave a stink if it's not dealt with properly. There are consequences to sin. The great thing about us Christians is God forgives us of our sins, right? But there can still be lingering effects of sin. Remember when Lazarus was called out of the tomb, the disciples were instructed, take the grave clothes off of them because they stink, right? God can remove that and cleanse you. Isn't that a cool thing about our God? Our God is so awesome. But never, ever, ever take God's mercy for granted. Look what happens in verse 15. But the Pharaoh saw that there was relief. And again, most people come to God just looking for relief from their pain. He hardened his heart and he did not heed them as the Lord had said. Now, get ready for plague 3. You think frogs are bad? I'm going to be honest with you. This whole week I was so tempted to read these next few verses, and while I read them I was going to just very subtly and secretly start doing this. Just to see how many of you would start doing this. Because check this out. This is gross. So the Lord said to Moses, "You say to Aaron, stretch out your rod, strike the dust of the land, so that it may all become lice throughout all the land of Egypt." Isn't that cool? And they did so. Now, Pharaoh didn't get no warning on this. He just struck the ground, lice. Now, some Bibles say mosquitoes. Some say gnawing gnats. We're not sure the actual word for it is spelled K-I-N-N-I-M. And it's also used to describe lice, mosquitoes, and these stinging gnats. They're described as small creatures that will fly and like to gather in the eyes, ears, and nostrils of the animal that they are attacking to bring madness. Isn't that gross? Now, this is also a duel with the worship in Egypt, because the Egyptians were real stuck on cleanliness. That's why they would shave their entire bodies. Their priests would bathe over and over through the day. So now their animals are infested with lice. They are infested with lice. So now they can't even worship, right? They're smelling the stink of the frogs. They're itching all over. And God is going, "I'm just getting started." Right? Now look what happens with, well, verse 17. So they did so. For Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and struck the dust of the earth, and it became lice on man and on the beast. Like I say, now it's affecting the animals. All of the dust of the land became lice throughout all the land of Egypt. Now check this out, verse 18. Here's where things shift a little bit. Now the magicians, these satanic inspired warlocks, they so worked with their enchantments to bring forth lice, but they could not. Friends, if you're taking notes, this is a good one to write down. Satan can't give life. Only God can. Satan only brings death. Jesus came so that we might have life and have life more abundantly. They couldn't produce out of the dirt which man was originally made from, right? That's why, ladies, when you call us dirt bags, we don't argue. They couldn't produce life. And look what they did. So the magician said to Pharaoh, verse 19, "This is the finger of God." They acknowledge that this is true what these guys are saying. Now remember earlier, Moses and Aaron said, "If you don't let us go, you're going to feel the mighty hand of God." And the magicians are saying, "This is just his finger." I did this little illustration Wednesday night for a different topic about spiritual gifts, but I think it's appropriate here. I need a volunteer. All right, well, let me explain it, and then I'll ask for volunteers. Okay, I've got 5 digits, because I was told Wednesday that I have 4 fingers and 1 thumb. Right? Now, here's what I needed a volunteer for. I was going to need a volunteer, and I was going to poke him in the chest. That don't hurt too bad, does it? Right? Right? But if I take these 5 digits, and I make a fist, and I punch somebody, it'd make a difference, right? The magicians are saying, "Pharaoh, we're getting the poke from this Hebrew God, Jehovah. Don't make him mad where he makes the fist," right? They are acknowledging that. Now, does anyone want to volunteer? Darn it. This is the finger of God, and he's about to turn things tough on us. Well, look at verse 20. I'm still verse 19. Pharaoh's heart grew hardened. He didn't heed them. Now, he's dealing with the stench of dead frogs in his nose. He's got lice all over him. And it's just a mess. So God tells Moses in verse 20, Now the Lord said to Moses, rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh as he comes out to the water. Again, they were worshiping the Nile and doing their whole thing. Then say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me, or else. Here's the first time. They're dealing with this, and God is just now saying, or else. Or else, if you will not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms of flies on you and on your servants. Ugh. Of all the creatures that God made, flies are the worst, right? Oh, I hate flies. And they're going to be on your people and on your servants and in your houses. The houses of the Egyptians shall be full of swarms of flies, and on the ground which you stand are going to be all of those. Now check this out in verse 22. Here's where it really gets cool. And in that day, I will set apart the land of Goshen in which my people dwell, that no swarms of flies shall be there, in order that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the land. I will make a difference between my people and your people. Tomorrow, you wanted the frogs gone tomorrow? Tomorrow, I'm going to send the flies. Tomorrow, this sign shall be. And the Lord did so. Thick swarms of flies came into the house of Pharaoh and into his servants' houses and then into all the land of Egypt. The land was corrupted because of the flies. Now, here, God says, I'm going to make a distinction between Egypt and Goshen. Goshen was the land that when Joseph brought his family there, the Egyptians gave to him. Okay, that's your land. The rest is Egypt. Okay, and God says, I am no longer going to allow the effects of these plagues go into Goshen. Now, how do you stop a fly? Right? I mean, some people put pennies in a Ziploc baggie with water. Does that work, Lucy? It does work? Practicing witchcraft. The joke is, how do you draw a line and tell a fly don't cross the line? But God says, I'm going to do that. And he did that. He says, I'm going to make a distinction between my people and your people. Friends, there should be, when people see us and know us and hear us talk, they should know that we're Christians. Right? We reflect more of the world than of Christ. That's wrong. We need to be reflectors of Christ. Right? Our churches should be reflectors of Christ, not reflectors of Egypt. And now, what would happen is, if the people left Goshen and went to Egypt, they had to deal with the flies. When we get out of the covering and the grace of God, don't be surprised if you got to deal with life. Now, there are some things, the first few plagues, the Hebrew people had to suffer through. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust, right? Now, just because we're Christians doesn't mean we'll never have a heart attack. Doesn't mean, you know, we won't have some tragedy just because we're Christian. We're not immune to things of the world. It rains on the just and the unjust. But can I say this, and please don't take this as pride or bragging or anything, but I don't have to ever worry about becoming a drug addict. Don't do drugs. Right? So there are some things that we can expose ourselves to and cause ourselves some great problems. Right? We can leave Goshen and go into Egypt. Is this making sense? Right? If you don't drink, you don't have to worry about becoming an alcoholic. If you don't skydive, you never have to worry about crashing. I just threw that out because I couldn't think of nothing else. But you know what I'm saying, right? I mean, there are choices that we can make that will affect an outcome in our life. We can choose to stay in God's Goshen, or we can choose to step out into Egypt and deal with the flies. Does that make sense? The whole thing? So he says, I'm drawing this line. Flies can't cross. And this tells Egypt two things. Number one, it tells them that God, Jehovah, is in control, and that the Hebrew people, God cares for them. The Apostle Peter tells us in 2 Peter 3:10 that God is waiting patiently, giving everyone a chance to repent. But once God appears, it'd be like a thief in the night. Friends, we've got to be ready. tomorrow, Pharaoh, tomorrow. So, unfortunately, the tomorrow came. Verse 24 said the land was corrupted. For the overhead, please, Bonnie, Psalms 78, 45, and 46. He sent swarms of flies among them, which devoured them, and frogs which destroyed them. It doesn't say it in our reading in Exodus, but the psalmist tells us that the frogs and the flies were actually causing physical death. That's some gross stuff, isn't it? So it corrupted the land. Let's keep reading and finish this up. I'm so far behind my notes, but I think I can catch up. Verse 25, and Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron, and this is funny, he says, go sacrifice to your God. But notice he says, in the land. See, the world will offer you a compromise. What was their request? We're going 3 days in the wilderness. Here, Pharaoh says, you can worship God, but you got to worship him here. Right? And compromise number one is you can do anything you want, just don't completely and fully commit yourself to God. See, this is what the enemy says to us. You can do your God thing, but do it here. Friends, I have a problem with these big churches that basically say the same thing. That they're more like a nightclub than they are a sanctuary. Right? You know what I'm saying? Now, why couldn't the people worship God there? Well, a couple of reasons. Number one, if you're a slave in Egypt, and you're in Egypt, you're a slave. He goes on to say the next one here. He says in verse 26, it is not right to do so, for we would be sacrificing the abomination of the Egyptians to the Lord our God. If we sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptians before their eyes, they will stone us. He says, your people aren't going to like the way we worship. You know, there's a lot of people that don't like the fact that you worship or how you worship. The Egyptians, they had sacred cows. And God required a sacrifice of a heifer. So he says, if we do it here, we'll offend you. Friends, sometimes living for Christ is offensive to other people who don't know Christ. Right? So he says, you know, we can't do that. We can't. Also notice, if you're taking notes, you can't properly worship God in the world. That's why we need to be reverent and holy as we worship God. Does that mean God doesn't like drums? No, it just means we don't have a drum player. But you guys know what I'm saying, right? You know, when it's all about the lights and the fog machines and that kind of stuff, and it's not about God, you don't have worship. You don't have worship. Well, let's keep reading here. In verse 27, Moses says, no, we're going to go 3 days' journey into the wilderness and sacrifice to the Lord our God there, as he commanded us. Right? As he commanded. We got to make sure that we do things the way God tells us to do. No shortcuts, no compromises. So Pharaoh makes him another deal. Well, I'll let you go that you may sacrifice to the Lord your God in the wilderness. Only don't go too far away. And please pray for me. The second compromise is, you know, don't go too far with this whole Jesus stuff. Don't go overboard. You know, it's okay to be a fanatic over a sports team or a rock band, but let's don't get crazy about this God stuff. Right? Let's, you know, you're really kind of pushing it with bumper stickers and that little funky fish that don't even have eyes. Why you even put that on your car? You know what I'm saying? You can worship this God, but don't take it too far. Don't take it too far. That's what he's saying. Friends, nothing more than total commitment. For Moses, it was non-negotiable. He says in verse 29, Moses says, indeed, I'm going out from you. I love this. He says what's happening. I'm going out. And I will entreat the Lord that the swarm of flies may depart tomorrow from Pharaoh, from his servants, and from his people. But let Pharaoh not deal deceitfully anymore in letting the people go and sacrifice to the Lord. Here Moses says, okay, you've done this to me 3 times now. You said we can go, then you change your mind. Don't do it again. Well, we know that Pharaoh's not that smart. Verse 30, so Moses went out from Pharaoh and entreated the Lord, and the Lord did according to the word of Moses. He removed the swarms of flies from Pharaoh and his servants and from his people. Not one remained. I need to get Moses praying at my house sometimes, right? But in this, Get rid of these flies. But look at what happens in verse 32. But Pharaoh hardened his heart at this time, neither would he let the people go. He still hardened his own heart at this point. And Pharaoh, like a lot of people, their minds change with their circumstances. When the circumstances are hard, we depend on God. We use God as a 911 instead of God being our life, right? We're going to stop there because if we get into the next plague, it'll take me a whole lot longer. So you guys mind getting out early? One amen. All right, let's stand and pray. Read the next couple of chapters. Not that we'll get through two chapters next week, but read them. Hey, you may have frogs irritating your life. You may have flies buzzing around your head. You may have lice crawling all over you. Hopefully not physically. But spiritually speaking, you may be dealing with issues. You may be dealing with stuff going on. Well, today's the day that God wants to say, I'm here for you. Today's the day that God wants to say, enough. I've drawn the line. You're safe in Goshen. Would you surrender yourself 100% to God and live in His Goshen? As the worship team plays, I'm going to pray. And then after I say amen, we're going to open up the altars for prayer, and we're going to invite you to come forward and pray at that time. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word. Lord, may we heed the warnings of the plagues. Father, we're very quick and very guilty of making gods out of silly things. Father, we're very guilty of making things more sacred than we make you. Father, many of us here are guilty of the compromises that Pharaoh was suggesting. Father, there may be people here today who only see you as a 911 God, but they live their life as Pharaoh. They want the relief of the pain and discomfort, but they don't want to serve you. Lord, today, would you break that mindset? Would you break that heart? Lord, would you truly set the captives free? Father, may we not be like Pharaoh suggested, and may we not be weak Christians, Lord. May we be sold out completely for you. Lord, many of us are guilty of trying to worship you in the land. Many of us are from the land. Lord, we see how that worked out for Samson. We see how it worked out for Lot. It's dangerous to live close to Egypt. So Lord, would you help us to live completely and 100% for you? Lord, I want to pray that today, Lord, you truly, truly would break bonds that are holding your people down. Father, in the name of Jesus, I speak healing and health to bodies, to families, to relationships, to finances, to jobs, to schools, Lord, whatever obstacles in our way, whatever weapon the enemy is using against us, we come against it now in the name of Jesus, and we speak freedom and strength and peace and hope in the name of Jesus. Lord, just as you said, your word accomplishes what it is sent out to do. Lord, we send your word out today to make a positive change and a great difference in lives, Lord. Father, thank you that we can study your word. We ask, as always, Holy Spirit, that you'd help us to meditate and dwell upon this chapter we looked at today. Lord, as we reread it, would you speak to our hearts even more? Make it personal and applicable to each and every one of us, Father. Lord, I thank you for the great privilege of sharing your word with these wonderful people. Father, just bring your blessing now to every family, every person, everyone hearing my voice. I speak a blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.